Welcome to Tuscaloosa, Alabama, for the annual November showdown between the antagonists, LSU and Alabama. Nick Saban, the head coach of the top-ranked Crimson Tide, preparing to face his former team for the seventh time in the regular season. And the man who replaced him in Baton Rouge, Les Miles and the Bayou Tigers, the only team to defeat Alabama multiple times during this span. Nighttime in Tuscaloosa, Bryant Denny Stadium, it is filled to the brim. Those of us who love this sport live for nights like this.
It's coming. John Parker Wilson, fumble. LSU has recovered.
Great game. Good luck to you.
John Parker Wilson keeps it. He is in. Touchdown, Alabama. The chase is on, and it will be won by Julio Jones.
Toss, reverse. Here comes Peterson.
Well, that faked everybody out. Hand off to Ridley, and he is in for the score.
Hayes puts it up.
Which way? Which way? Intercepted.
How about that?
I can tell you for sure now, LSU wins.
Screen pass, yelled it. Are here in enormous numbers. Oh yes, LSU is well represented as well. Their fans will try to outshout those of the Crimson Tide. That's a formidable task in this full house. And we welcome you to the Home Depot SEC on CBS. Tigers and Crimson Tide.
Good evening, everybody. I'm Vern Lundquist, along with Gary Danielson and Tracy Wolfson. This place is packed, as you might expect. This annual gathering between LSU and Alabama, it's a rivalry whose intensity is almost unmatched in recent years in all of college football. Let's take a look at one reason why. The SEC West standings, these are up to date, shows Alabama controls its own destiny. LSU, to get to Atlanta in the championship game, needs to win tonight and then get a little help. Even more significant in the national picture, Alabama, the current standings entering this week with the number one spot in the BCS, followed by Florida State, Oregon, and then kaboom on Thursday night as Stanford knocked off Oregon. We'll see who winds up in the number three spots. Gary, this we've been lucky to be a part of this in recent years. These two teams seem to have been put together in such similar fashions.
Vern, they've really earned this matchup. You know, every game has been so close, and when you look at the series between Saban and Les Miles, you can see how tight these football games have been. This includes that one BCS championship game when Alabama 21-0, but look how close. Regular season is 3-3, 4-3, obviously with the championship, but this game means something. That's why everybody wants to watch it. That's why we're so lucky to be here.
Well, Nick Saban has a deserved reputation as an excellent defensive coach. This season, no different.
You know, Vern, you're right. You're not going to win three BCS championships by fooling people. They have built a great defense at every level. Whether they're rushing the passer from the outside, the inside, or stopping the run with those great linebackers, and they take it into the secondary where Nick actually has a personal hand in coaching those guys. This defense is elite. It's been elite since 2008. They don't give up anything easy.
This has been a year of outstanding quarterback play in the SEC. We've got two of the best here tonight. Let's begin, Gary, with A.J. McCarron.
Well, you know, when you look at these two quarterbacks, A.J. McCarron for Alabama and Zach Mettenberger for LSU, I think when you get in this type of game to win a championship, to beat Alabama, you're going to have to take A.J. McCarron's best game. Now, he hasn't played ultimately his best game except for the BCS championship against LSU, but he had that great drive to finish up that game, and I got to believe he's ready for this game tonight. Now, Zach Mettenberger is part of my formula. I've done a ton of games with you and watched Alabama probably more than any other team. You must be elite at quarterback. Johnny Manziel did it. Between there, it's been pretty empty. Up comes Zach Mettenberger. Can he be elite tonight? He's going to have to be.
Well, LSU has played very well in this stadium over the years. What's their formula for victory tonight?
You're going to have to play well in all phases, obviously. But to beat Alabama, as I said, you're not going to trick them. You have to be able to stand up and take them on physically, stopping the run and also running the ball. Jeremy Hill is big, 234 pounds. He must be a factor in the game to take the pressure off Mettenberger. But I really believe that if a pressure point can be made in this football game, LSU can do it with their two elite receivers. Odell Beckham causes a mismatch. Jarvis Landry, even when he's covered, Mettenberger will throw the game. This is where LSU can break down Alabama if they have a chance to win.
All right, Gary, in the first on the field, the defending national champions and currently top-ranked Crimson Tide under Nick Saban's leadership, 8-0. Moments ago, under the leadership of their head coach, Les Miles, the Tigers of LSU just another average evening in Tuscaloosa. We've still got a football game to be played. We are set to play moments ago, Tracy, with Nick Saban.
Coach, you told me in this matchup, your team always plays way too tight. How do you change that tonight?
Well, you know, I think our guys are ready to go. They seem to be pretty focused, pretty ready to go. You know, if you're a competitor, you love games like this. So, you know, everything we've tried to sort of get our team to train to be able to do is focus on doing their job, play hard, play with effort, dominate their space. We'll see how it goes against a good team.
Good luck tonight.
All right, thank you.
As you all know, Tracy Wolfson is the hardest working journalist in sports television. She's also a sprinter. She caught up with Les Miles moments ago.
Coach, you come in a big underdog. Does your team feel disrespected considering how you played Alabama in the past?
Absolutely not. We're coming in here looking forward to playing our best, competing with a fine football team, a great opponent. Underdogs never crossed our mind, I promise you. We always decide where we finish. It's going to be that kind of night.
Thanks a lot. Come on.
Thank you.
I wish he'd get a little animated every once in a while, don't you?
Well, I bet that word was never used in their locker room. I'll bet they're looking forward. They believe that they can play on this field, and that's half the game playing against Alabama. You have to believe you belong.
Christian Jones back to return the kickoff. He leads the country 32.7 yards, including this one in the season opener, 94 yards against Virginia Tech. LSU won the toss, deferred the option to the second half, and James Hairston, he's kicked off 65 times this year. 40 of them have been touchbacks. And Jones elects to bring it out. He is across the 21. There's a flag down. Corey Thompson, number 12, made the tackle.
Matt Austin is our referee tonight.
They'll start at the 10-yard line if it's against Alabama.
During the return, holding, 18 receiving team, 10-yard penalty, first down.
And after the penalty is marked off, let's introduce you to the Chick-fil-A starting lineups. And here is A.J. McCarron.
What's interesting is these games are not played in a vacuum. Remember last year, LSU started the game with 19 plays to 3 versus Alabama. A.J. McCarron started out 1 for 5. Will Nick try to get him loosened up early in this football game?
And look at the raindrops beginning to be scattered throughout the stadium. Here's the handoff to T.J. Yeldon. What a nifty move when he got into the secondary. 13-yard gain.
Well, there's two ways you can loosen up your quarterback. One is by throwing, but the other is having a great running game in front of you.
And it was Yeldon who, a year ago in Baton Rouge, caught that touchdown pass from Yeldon for the winning score in a 21-17 victory. First down, 10. They'll give it to Yeldon again. He darts up the middle. And let's check the Crimson Tide offense. The Quanjo brothers at left tackle, left guard. Ryan Kelly back in the starting spot at center. Down at the bottom, Kevin Norwood having a splendid senior season. He has become in many ways the go-to guy for A.J. McCarron. Second down and 2.
Different look for LSU. Alabama putting their tight end wide early in this game to signify formations. Remember, LSU has struggled with mistakes in the secondary.
That was Brian Vogler. Here's a little crossing pass underneath, and it's the aforementioned Kevin Norwood, number 83, one of the heroes in last year's victory. Defensively now, Jamarie Rasko, Johnson and Ferguson, the interior lineman. Quan Alexander has assumed a starting spot at strong side linebacker. He's actually from Oxford, Alabama, had 14 tackles in the most recent LSU victory. 14. Now on first down, 10, McCarron out of the spread. Sends Yeldon in motion. Blitz coming from the corner. McCarron dances right, fires it incomplete for DeAndre White. He was followed by the middle linebacker, DJ Welter.
If you want to see an important phase of this football game, watch the defensive tackles for LSU. Number 9, Ferguson. Number 90, Anthony Johnson. They must build a wall inside. This is a team this year that has not produced a lot of tackles for losses, but if they can control the 3 inside blockers for Alabama just a bit, that'll be huge for this LSU defense.
Christian Jones and Amari Cooper top of the screen. And out of the spread, here's McCarron, the handoff, Yeldon this time. There you go, Gary, just what you were talking about. That's Ego Ferguson, number 9, who makes the tackle. Anthony Johnson also there.
Well, to be an elite defense, we talked about Alabama's elite defense, but there's 2 of them that have been on the field the last 2 years together, and 11 and 12. This year, not quite the same. They took a lot of players off this defense.
Third down, 9, first third down of the early going. Alabama with troubles in this series on third downs in recent years. McCarron, pressure comes from Johnson. McCarron, incomplete to Yeldon.
Yeah, and even if it was completed, it would have not been for a first down. LSU's third down defense, but as you mentioned, John Chavis has given Alabama fits on third down the last 3 years in this series.
That's going to bring on Cody Mandel, and Odell Beckham is deep to return it. How about this stat? Cody Mandel has only had 5 punts in the last 4 games. So dominant has been the Alabama team. Fourth and 9. Beckham on one hop, 20, 30 and out of bounds.
Yeah, we're going to get a flag
and
on
a flag.
This one,
yep.
too. You know, I really love when the punt returner does that, Vern. When he can make 10 yards on a bouncing punt, it saves 20 yards sometimes, because that ball can roll a long way. Beckham, very aggressive, makes a play, and then a mistake by, could have been LSU, don't know for sure yet, but if it is, it'll almost be mirror image of what happened to Alabama when they got the ball.
Looks like it might have
during
been
the return,
James Wright.
Holding, receiving team, 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul, first down.
Well, Matt Austin did not identify him, but
I think you're right. It was number 82, James
yes.
Wright.
Yep. Zach Mettenberger is going to be on the field when we return. The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Kia. The Home Depot, Liberty Mutual Insurance, and by Coke Zero. We are scoreless. Early moments of the ballgame, 12:07 to go in the first quarter. And now the Chick-fil-A starting lineups, and we begin with the quarterback, Zach Mettenberger.
I felt on the field, I was down there tonight just to look at him, I thought extremely focused. Sometimes, he had that same look that he had before the Georgia game. And he loves these big football games. He's waited his whole life to play these SEC big football games.
Well, Mettenberger, the game Gary referenced, that was a return to his hometown in Athens back in September. A thrilling ball game, though LSU lost to Georgia 44-41. Connor Neighbors opens at fullback, number 43, and Jeremy Hill is the tailback. And this old-fashioned eye, Hill follows Neighbors, and a nice gain on first down. Offensively now for LSU, Lyle Collins, though hampered slightly by an injury, will start. Alexander Collins, we thought, might have to sit out this one, so good for him that he's there. See the rest of the offensive line. J.C. Copeland is back at fullback, but he did not start. It's Neighbors who gets the start. Copeland suffered a concussion 2 weeks ago and missed the last two games. We were told he was ready, but Neighbors is out there, and this is Landry. Oh, kinds of times. Sidearm. Jeremy Hill. C.J. Mosley, who leads Alabama in tackles with 59, made that one.
One of the things that all of the LSU players have commented on is how disciplined this Alabama defense is. And Zach said, I must drop it off and not force that ball downfield unless I just have to. That was a good drop off on second down. They get third and short as a result.
Copeland now on the field on third and one. He's number 44. Toss. They cut inside. Lyle Collins out there, and that should be enough to move the chain.
I'll tell you, this is grown real football right here.
Oh.
You got to take on number 44, but look at the stick coming up by Trey DePries. Holy man.
And that was force against force, wasn't it? First
yep.
down 10.
Trey DePries took on 44.
Yes. Here's Hill. No block on the edge, and the tackle is made by Landon Collins, the sophomore who got the start when Vinny Sanceri went out for the year with a knee injury.
Well, I don't think there's any doubt that Vinny Sanceri is a quarterback of this defense. And when Sanceri went down, they replaced him with a more athletic guy and a bigger hitter. Now, will the communication work and the coverages work? That remains to be seen. But this is a guy that can come out and take on the running game.
Now, they've also got Ha-Ha Clinton Dix back for the second week after a two-game suspension. Play action, Mettenberger. Lets it go deep left side, man open. That's Jarvis Landry. And he beat Deion Blue. These are two wonderfully gifted receivers for LSU.
Well, what a great job by Zach Mettenberger reading this defense. defense, when he has his pre-snap, Alabama gets him two deep safeties. But one of the safeties comes up. Now watch this. When he comes up, Mettenberger says, I can go for the play.
And Terrence McGee, number 14, gets the opportunity on a quick snap.
That safety vacates, and all of a sudden, a beautiful placed ball right to Landry.
Oh, Mettenberger dropped it in beautifully.
Yes, he did.
That was a 45-yard gain. Here is the toss, and McGee comes with the ball carried in his left arm, and he's knocked out of bounds by Ha-Ha Clinton Dix, number 6.
Down, and Alexander comes around. And there's a lot to come around when Alexander does it. Played tackle last year and a pulling guard on that play. A massive man coming around.
Landry and Beckham both to the right side. Landry in the slot. It's McGee, still the running back, and he plunges right up the middle. You saw Ha-Ha Clinton Dix trying to rip the ball out. And let's take a look at the LSU red zone offensive numbers presented by Verizon. 70% touchdowns on 43, 30 of 43.
Just to set the scene here, Vern, neither team has scored a touchdown in the first quarter in this game since 2008. That's five games. This is a big deal here. Points are grudgingly given up. Touchdowns almost never early in this series.
And LSU is on the lip of the cup. That's McGee in motion, leading Copeland behind Mettenberger. It's Copeland. He scores on every...
He fumbled it.
He fumbled it. And Landon Collins comes up with it. Turnover. Alabama football. Number 11,
and he swatted for the ball. He tried to make the play, and he did make the play. Let's find him. I think he's right here.
Yep.
Comes off the edge, takes on the block, and then he makes the play. What a play. Look at that swat. His right hand right on the football. You could almost feel Copeland sensing the end zone, and he didn't finish the play.
First turnover of the ball game. Alabama's got the ball.
I know you like to watch your football, and I know you're not supposed to assume things, but Zach Mettenberger assumed a touchdown in this one, and Vern, you know that word can be broken apart.
Mm-hmm. Nicely put. Very subtle. Well, look at the turnover differential. Saw the huge margin last year. That's the 8th fumble lost by LSU. And Alabama takes over after the turnover at their own 10-yard line.
And still no touchdowns for five games. How about that goal line stand by Alabama?
Twin tight ends for the Crimson Tide. It'll be Yeldon. A little shifty change of balance in the backfield. And he gets 5 yards on first down. Ego Ferguson, number 9, and Trent Dominguez make the tackle. Second down, 5. Jones, nice defensive job. That's Tre'Davious White, number 16.
And one of those young football players, just a freshman, that makes the play on this one to the outside and forces Alabama into another third down situation. Part of the football game that LSU has dominated despite losing these football games. 0-for-1 tonight. They were 25% was Alabama in the last three games going against this LSU defense.
Yeldon breaks and comes wide to the left. There's a bunch of receivers at the top of the screen. See what LSU has in mind defensively. They bring 5. And one's caught, but short of the first down.
It's going to be very close. Giving him forward progress, almost touching the line. Thought he got a friendly spot on that one, to tell you the truth.
That's a bad spot.
Another look.
Remember, this is a reviewable play on these first down calls. I thought it was very, very generous. Let's put it that way.
Another subtle comment.
It's early in the game.
Yes, yeah.
Now, what do you do? Hey, he's going to punt the ball, don't you think? I would.
I do.
I can't. You got to depend on your defense. You built a great defense. You've got to trust it.
And it appears that's what Nick Saban has decided. Mandel on for the second time. Mentioned he had 22 punts in the first four games and only five punts in the last four, and he's got Beckham, ever dangerous Odell Beckham, back to return.
You think playing Kentucky, Arkansas, Tennessee, and Ole Miss have anything to do with that?
I wasn't.
Not a lot of wins there.
I wasn't going to bring that up.
Alabama dominated those teams.
Well, they gave up 42 points to Johnny Manziel and the Aggies in their second game, and not many since, but the quality of the opposition, a little shaky. On fourth down. Beckham, fair catch. Taken. Oh. At the 38-yard line. 42-yard punt, nothing on the return. Les Miles, believe it or not, in his ninth year. And the guy he replaced is the head coach at LSU.
Adam Zucker in New York with the Heisman Watch presented by Nissan. Earlier on CBS, we saw Johnny Manziel in perhaps his final home game go for nearly 500 total yards, five touchdown passes in a 51-41 win over Mississippi State. Thursday, Marcus Mariota's Heisman hopes took a hit in the loss at Stanford, and Bryce Petty got a boost, five total touchdowns against Oklahoma. Perhaps a Heisman moment coming from A.J. McCarron tonight. Vernon Gary.
Well, he's got the opportunity, Adam, that is for sure. Let's take a look at the first drive.
And I think LSU did a little bit of everything they needed. Not only did they get the big plays and serve notice that those two receivers have to be defended on every play with safety protection, but they also showed they could run the ball. Just when they thought they had 7 points, a play was made. And Alabama stayed alive, keeping this game a shutout. Let me be nice to my Ole Miss friends here. That is a combined record of 4-20 for those four teams. But Ole Miss is 3-3, and they did beat LSU in Texas.
Yes, they did.
Just so I'd be fair here. Could not match up physically, though, with Alabama in that football game.
And in that game in Oxford, that was a three-point Ole Miss win. Mettenberger threw three interceptions.
Well, here we go.
Sacked. Trey DePriest, number 33, an early defensive presence for the Crimson Tide in this game.
One of the coaching points against Alabama is they love to build a wall. They don't really try to penetrate. But this time, against the scouting report, Alabama dials up an inside blitz, and it was completely whiffed by LSU.
That's a loss of six. Second down, 16. Crowd had grown quiet on that last LSU possession, and now they're back in it.
Play a game. And there are 4 clocks.
Prior to the snap, delay of game, number 8 of the offense. 5-yard penalty.
Vern, I went down on the field. There are 4 play clocks that the quarterback can check. 2 at almost eye level in the corners and 2 up on the scoreboard that are very easy to see. So there's 2 low, and then if you raise your eyes a little bit more, there's 2 more on the facade. Right up there, very easy to see from the field.
Landry and Beckham wide to the left. Kadren Boone.
Oh, no. Oh, no.
Another one.
Mettenberger was going to change the play, and Porter snapped it. A flag is down, though. Did Porter snap it thinking that Alabama was in the neutral zone?
Offense number 8, moving forward to the snap. That penalty's declined. Play results in full.
That's Trey DePriest, who's now become even more of a presence. Look at that.
You could see what happened. The crowd noise. Zach Mettenberger was trying to move up and change the play. Porter thought he saw the foot move, and he snapped the ball in the silent count.
Well, hit him right in the stomach. And so a second fumble recovery now by Alabama.
I tell you, Les is still questioning what happened and why the center snapped the ball. He was thinking that Alabama was in the neutral zone. They were not. Let's see if there's any movement. Go, if we could go back one more time. Watch Alexander signal to Porter to snap the ball by tapping him. Watch this. Left guard. Just before, we got to go back just a little farther after this play.
And a first down 10, play action. A.J. McCarron looking deep, lost it in the end zone. Overshoots O.J. Howard.
Again, miscommunication. Let's go back to the fumbled snap. Alexander will tap the center to signify the beginning of the play. See? The tap. Then Mettenberger changes his mind, and that's the miscommunication.
There's Alexander, Vidal Alexander, the left guard.
Had three guys involved in that one.
Yeah. Second down, 10, under 5 to go, opening quarter. Yeldon inside the 25 and into the arms of Anthony Johnson, number 90. Third and 7, another third down for Alabama. They've missed on their first two. And as you pointed out, this has been a problem for them against LSU.
Well, one of the reasons last year's game, LSU ran 85 plays, still lost the football game, but the reason was Alabama couldn't convert on third down.
Four wides on 3rd and 7. Blitz again. McCarron, right side. Christian Jones is open.
That was miscommunication. A.J. threw that to the near pylon for the end zone. The receiver and A.J. were not on the same page. Wide open down here. This is where A.J. threw it. The receiver was running a deeper ball. He knows he has him. He lets it go. He's got Christian. And I wonder if Christian Jones broke off his route because he was so open on the play and didn't finish his design route.
Here's Cade Foster, who is 8 of 9 for the year. This is measured at 41 yards. His only miss was from 46. Nice job of holding the ball. Got it placed properly. And the scoreless tie has been broken. Mettenberger with the miscommunication, his center and his left guard.
Yeah, but that was a great stop by the LSU defense. A great stop. A little help from Alabama on a miscommunication of their own. But for LSU, after that turnover, a huge stop.
Doubleheader tomorrow, the NFL Today on CBS. Lead game early, Cincinnati at Baltimore. Greg Gumbel, Dan Dierdorf will be there. Lead game late, Denver at San Diego. Jim Nance, Bill Sims out west. And it all begins with the NFL Today, presented by Southwest Airlines at 12 noon. 3:54 to go. Let's go back, Gary, and look at the miscommunication.
Well, on the silent count, you have more than one signal. And Zach Mettenberger did his leg one time and then used his thumbs. I guess it must be leg, thumb, leg. You can see the discussion. One guy whose fault it wasn't was Porter. He was just doing what he was told to do.
So after the fumble, on the botched snap. Kate Foster kicks one over from 41 yards out. He is going to, Kate Foster will kick off. And Odell Beckham Jr., number three, in the end zone awaiting the kick. Moves up, grabs it at the five. Missed tackle. Another missed tackle. And a fine return for Beckham. That's 39 yards.
Well, that's usually what Christian Jones gives this Alabama offense. Odell Beckham just gave LSU. From this spot on the field, when you cross the 40-yard line, you have 100% of your offense to run. When you're backed up about the 20, 25, you're down about 70, 60% of your offense. Right now, anything that Cam Cameron dials up could be called.
And a bit of irony, that was Christian Jones, the return specialist for Alabama, who made the tackle on Odell Beckham. First down 10 at the 43. Tigers trail 3-0. Jeremy Hill. He's tackled, and that gives us time to go back to the studio for a Ford update. Here's Adam.
All right, Vern, thank you. We've seen Nick Saban's name tied to the Texas Longhorns this week. Right now, Mac Brown's squad trailing at West Virginia in search of their sixth straight win. Back to you.
And on second down, Hill is pushed backward. Xavier Dixon, number 47, at the top of it all. And A'shaun Robinson, number 86, was down at the bottom. I know you're very fond of the way he's playing.
He really has come on. I mean, he is one, an elite player, just a freshman, getting better every week.
That's number 86, who will come off the field now on third and four. Three wides. Alabama with three down. Adrian Hubbard, number 42, looks over at the sidelines. Play action, got him. Beckham caught from behind by Cyrus Jones, but that's good for a first down.
Recall our opening game that we did when Texas A&M and Mike Evans broke down the Alabama defense. These two receivers are not as big, obviously, as Evans, but they can break down a defense. Right there, you could see Cyrus Jones in man-to-man coverage, just abused by Odell Beckham.
McGee, stiff arm, doesn't matter. Landon Collins, the sophomore, with the tackle.
Well, that's what we talk about, Landon Collins, how athletic he is.
Well, he's a five-star recruit. He is from Louisiana. And it is said that his mom was somewhat disappointed when he decided to go to Alabama. Second down and 10. Connor Neighbors is now the fullback, number 43. He's a guy with mixed heritage, too. He's from Huntsville, Alabama. Here's Neighbors setting up the block. They hand it off to McGee. C.J. Mosley. That's 61 tackles for the season for the All-American. 25 more than number two in the Alabama defense.
Well, you know about C.J. Mosley in this football game. He's in there in regular. Last year in this football game, he did not play one snap against regular. He was only involved in the nickel and dime package.
And he wasn't happy about it.
No, he wasn't. It wasn't until the last series against Georgia in the SEC championship and, of course, the Notre Dame game that he won his job back.
Alabama showing blitz. Maybe check out of it. Delayed blitz. Mettenberger hit as he lets it go. He's got Landry.
Well, this is the story of last year's game. Mettenberger throwing the football when he's under duress and completing it. Watch him step in and throw this ball when he's got Pagan right in his chest.
8-on-8. Mettenberger limping as he comes up to the line. He did complete the pass to Landry. 26 seconds to go, opening quarter. and the second trip inside the red zone for the Tigers. They fumbled at the two on Copeland's carry earlier. This is Jeremy Hill trying to turn the corner. He does. Look at that collision. Deion Blue, number 13, at the three-yard line.
Jeremy Hill was very disappointed with his style of running against LSU. Against Alabama last year. He said, I was too much finesse. I bounced out too many plays. I am going to run physical tonight, and he has been.
That'll wind up play in the first quarter. And they have got a long walk, both teams do, to the opposite end of the stadium. Mettenberger limping on the hit from Taken. That's the end of the first quarter, 3-0 for the moment. We'll return to Tuscaloosa after this message and a word from your local station. Stadium, Tuscaloosa, Alabama. We begin the second. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson. I don't think either of us surprised that LSU is playing well.
No. When you bring a quarterback of the ability of Zach Mettenberger into the game and these two great wide receivers, it's going to challenge anybody. When you look at Beckham and you look at Landry, I mean, they get open in the NFL.
Right.
This is a challenge for anybody to stop these guys. Mettenberger started 4-for-4. He's playing at the high level needed to beat a great defense. He's got to keep it up. But I think LSU loves the way this game has started.
That's the man who hit Mettenberger a few moments ago. Here's the quick count. Up the middle, it's Hill. Touchdown, Tigers.
Man, you think about where LSU is right now. They've turned the ball over twice in this game, and they're leading in the football game. Power inside, following the fullback, puts it right into the end zone. That is the only way you can beat Alabama. You must be able to match up physically. The Alabama coaches said they out-physical this last year, and they're doing it again to start this football game.
That is only the third touchdown scored against the Alabama defense since the A&M game. Number three. It is the first touchdown given up by Alabama's defense in the second quarter all season. And we're back live. There was a late flag thrown. And then we'll go down to Matt Austin as soon as they straighten it out. Did you see the water splash up? That's what 20% chance of rain looks like.
Looks like it's going to be declined. At least the two teams think so.
Offside, defense number 5. Kelly's declined. Kick is good.
All righty.
Timeout.
I think Alabama lined up in the neutral zone on that play.
Gotcha. Zach Mettenberger. Les Miles. Nick Saban. And the guy who scored the TD, Jeremy Hill. What's at stake? Leadership in the SEC West.
Seems like there's more at stake than that if you're Les Miles, doesn't it? The ability to live a nice life.
It's coming. John Parker Wilson, fumble. LSU has recovered.
Yeah, great game. Good luck to you.
I would say, Gary, that he's living a nice life, don't you think?
I don't think that was understated in that 2007 game. That was the one Les had to have.
Yeah. And Jeremy Hill just scored the touchdown. And in the process, his 25th career rushing touchdown. Look who he passed. Billy Cannon, one of the iconic figures in all of LSU football.
And you can't believe how big and massive Hill is until you're on the field and standing next to him. 234 pounds, I was told. And he, you know, he's girly big. That type of the running back for Georgia. I mean, that type of size.
You are spelling G-U-R-L-E-Y.
Gershel, girly.
Yeah, there you are. James Harrison will kick off. Again, he's an excellent kickoff man. And this one will be returned. DeAndre White, number two, tackled nicely at the 22-yard line. It's an all-new night of comedy on CBS, beginning with How I Met Your Mother and Two Broke Girls, followed by a new Mike and Molly, and then Mom. It all starts Monday at 8, 7 Central, only CBS.
Well, what does Doug Nussmeier, the coordinator for Alabama, do now? A.J. McCarron started off last year's game 1-for-5. He's 3-for-7 now. Do they open the game up and try to get this passing game going for Alabama?
Well, they've gone with the speed back now. Kenyon Drake, number 17, is behind McCarron, and he gets the handoff, heads left. Like I said, the speed back. Ronald Martin, number 26, made the tackle.
Well, it's that two-headed monster of running back position at Alabama. Drake has won that second spot. You know, it started years ago. They've had two good ones every year. Last year was Lacy and Yeldon. Now Yeldon is the leader, and Drake is the second guy as the changeup.
Kenyon Drake still on the field after a gain of 15. Play action. Uh-oh. Jermarie Rasko, unimpeded, and he has sacked McCarron.
I mean, this was a naked play where you've got to assume that the defensive end will follow the play action to the other side. Didn't happen. Rasko went for the quarterback and played the quarterback all the way.
That is the first sack of the game. This offensive line of Alabama has not yielded many this year.
Not one in the last four games.
Second down, 17. McCarron lofts it out. It's caught by Drake. Breaks the tackle. He's out to the 40. Craig Lawson, number six.
Well, it's that dreaded screen pass that LSU faithful are saying, oh, no, not again. Had one last year at the end of the half. That was a big play, and of course, at the end of the game, that ultimately won it.
Early moments of the second quarter. It's another third down. This has been a problem for Alabama tonight, as it has been in this series. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson, Tracy Wolfson, and a 7-3 LSU lead, despite having lost two fumbles this evening. Now McCarron on 3rd and 9. Inside rush, good blocking. McCarron comes right. Incomplete to Amari Cooper. Rashard Robinson, number 21.
He's going to get called for grabbing the jersey or pass interference, it looks like, on this play. Cooper to the outside. Let's see who pushed off. Yes, he grabbed the jersey. You saw that?
Pass
easy call.
Defense 21. Ball will be placed in the spot of the foul. Automatic first down.
That's a big pickup for Alabama to pick that up. In the last 18 third and longs against LSU, Alabama's gone 2-for-18.
Wow.
That's how hard it's been for them to do it.
So on the penalty, they pick up a first at the 48-yard line, trailing by 4. O.J. Howard is split to the right side. They look for Howard.
Beautiful.
They've got him. One man to beat. He can't get him. Touchdown, Alabama. That's his longest catch of his freshman year.
And after we watch that guy run, remember, he's a tight end.
Foster out of McCarron's hold for the extra point. There is a flag down. O.J. Howard, that's his 11th catch of the season and his 4th touchdown.
We asked Doug Nussmeier yesterday about O.J. Howard. Might he break out?
71 of the kicking team. 5-yard penalty. We'll have a try.
I said he looks like a thoroughbred in practice. When will he break out? He said, you never know. That's the most Doug has ever told us to, right?
That is the truth.
He's under the silent count of Nick Saban.
Doug Nussmeier out of Idaho collegiately, and he replaced Jim McElwain as he is under the dome of Saban.
You bet.
Boy, he really is.
Don't blame him, though.
Who's starting at left tackle, Doug? You'll have to check with Coach on that.
Jalen Mills was matched up. Jalen Mills has played. He's a corner. Watch this matchup. Watch how easy it was. And then when he gets it, look at that man run. A freshman tight end takes it to the house.
And another look at this wonderfully conceived and executed 52-yard touchdown play. A.J. McCarron, our coverage continues after this word from your local station. The 52-yard scoring strike has given Alabama the lead once again. This drive helped along by a penalty on Rashard Robinson. Grabbed the jersey of Amari Cooper. That was on a third and long.
It was. And remember, that was after a big sack and then the second down screen pass. And this one was beautifully thrown. And then one of those five-star athletes. And Nick Saban and Alabama recruits took it to the house. Remember, both teams have those type of athletes. This game in 2011, that famous game in the rematch, already from that game, 31 players have been drafted in the NFL, and there's going to be another 10 from that game that are going to come out this year that probably will be drafted.
Well, that was that year's game of the century, a 9-6 overtime win for LSU. Those of us who were here and saw that live that night thought it was a heck of a contest. Some critics around the country thought it was dull.
Well, this one looks like a lot more fun right now.
Yeah, it does. You're right. Beckham takes it 7 yards deep. See more of today's game with the All-22 camera angle exclusively on CBSSports.com. Watch all the action live now at CBSSports.com/SEC. Appears there is a flag on that kickoff. By the way, just a mention of O.J. Of Odell Beckham. Among his accomplishments this year, he returned a missed field goal, 109 yards. Now, in college football, they don't measure beyond the end zone, so it went into the books as 100 yards.
Following the play, we have offsetting unsportsmanlike conduct penalty fouls on both teams. Number 25, Alabama. Number 52, LSU. Those fouls offset. First down.
Dylan Lee and Kendall Beckwith, Alabama and LSU, respectively.
By the way, remember those two names, two rising stars that will play in the future matchups of this game.
Ball at the 25. Mettenberger and the LSU offense. Take a look, Gary, at the very bottom of the screen.
Did not see it, but I'm told right on the bottom of the screen, right down in this area, I would assume.
Well, that's about as low as you can get.
Yep.
First down, 10. Jarvis Landry in motion. Blitz coming. Play action. Mettenberger. That's Jeremy Hill. Wow. Trey DePriest catching up from behind.
Let's give some credit now to the offensive coordinator for LSU, Cam Cameron. He's gotten a lot of ink this year, and Trey DePriest got a little too eager to stop the quarterback, and Cam Cameron dialed another wonderful play. Cam's in the middle.
Way down at the end is
coached
John
against,
Chavis. Yep.
Excuse me, Vern. Coached against Nick when he was at Michigan, and Nick was at Michigan State.
And a teammate of Les Miles. Jeremy Hill, number 33. C.J. Mosley with yet another tackle. 10-7, 11:50 to go, first half.
Interesting story, talking to Cam on the field before the game, and I said, have you ever been here before? And he said, yes. And I go, when? When did you ever coach here? He said, I was recruited by Bear Bryant. I was in here on the sideline. Jeff Rutledge was the quarterback, and I stood just like those guys right there.
Nice. C.J. Mosley, All-American a year ago with a chance to repeat.
Oh, he just shot the gap. Remember, this guy wasn't even in this package a year ago. An All-American football player shoots the gap. And that's a defense I don't think LSU has seen much of. Usually Alabama plays lanes, two gap up front, and let their linebackers run sideline to sideline. They've been attacking so far. One by DePreece, one by Mosley.
LSU has converted all three of its third downs thus far. Third and eight at the 50. All out blitz. Mettenberger somehow gets rid of it. One hops it to Travis Dixon, number 41. It was Denzel Duvall who made first contact defensively. Fourth down.
One of the things that Alabama did a year ago that I think they learned a lesson from is they were disguising their blitz too much. This year they're lining them up closer. I thought they came from too far away and allowed Mettenberger to make plays before they could get there. I think they moved up closer. I mean, when Vern calls up the blitz, I mean, no offense. But when you can
what
call,
are you saying?
That's not a very well designed.
I understand. Oh, what about this punt? Nope, limps into the end zone. That's Jamie Keen. I'll admit to being
a
target.
I've been waiting 7 years. You know, now we're good enough friends. We can do.
You're absolutely right. Well, C.J. Mosley wrapped up McGee, forced a punt. Alabama's got the ball back. Well, quite obviously, this is an arbitrary list, but it's kind of our top five. Manziel with a huge day-to-day, five touchdowns. Mariota with a tough loss Thursday night. A.J. McCarron should be in the mix. Bryce Petty of Baylor and the freshman Jameis Winston. The Aflac trivia question for tonight would be, which Alabama quarterback had the highest finish ever in the Heisman voting? That's the Aflac trivia question. And here is A.J. McCarron, 33-2 as a starting quarterback for the Crimson Tide. 5 of 9 with a touchdown in the early going. Kenyon Drake is the running back now. McCarron, Amari Cooper, spins, hit from behind. Bothered all year by a turf toe and is just rounding into shape in the last couple of games.
As you watch this pass, in this press box, we're at an angle when we look at this play. And actually, A.J. McCarron was throwing right at the angle to our spot in the press box. It was amazing how early he threw that ball. It looked like he was throwing it right at a linebacker's head. I mean, the level of passing has so risen in this league. Mettenberger and now McCarron are putting on a show of what you have to do to be successful when you throw the ball.
Hand off right side. It's Kenyon Drake out of a tackle and knocked out of bounds with a sizable gain. 1-2 punch. Yeldon and Drake, 14-yard gain.
Well, the running game is starting to spark now. When you start to throw the ball, now if I was LSU, they've had a couple gashing runs against them. I would be very careful if I was those safeties to read my keys, because this is when Alabama loves to run that play action pass and go deep on you.
Kevin Norwood is split to the left side on this play. And DeAndre White, bottom of the screen. Now Norwood comes in tight, quick screen. Amari, that's DeAndre White, number two.
This is a project of just reading the space that the defender gives the receiver. This was actually an option play. It could have been a run play, but A.J. sees the cushion to the outside and just throws it to the outside.
Back-to-back gains now, 14 yards and 13 yards and a first down. Crimson Tide. A.J. McCarron has hit four in a row. That's O.J. Howard. Comes in on a blocking assignment this time. And Drake struggles. DJ Welter, middle linebacker number 31, makes the stop. Nick Saban, by the way, told us yesterday he did watch Oregon Stanford.
He did. Said yeah. He watched. He took a kind of a postman's holiday, busman's holiday, and said, "I actually watched football all weekend. Usually I don't do that. He watched a little Michigan State, Michigan, and his bye week, and then he watched the Oregon game Thursday night."
Yeah, he said his wife Terry. He got home after doing his radio show. She said, "I'm going to watch the game." Second and nine. Underneath, Amari Cooper splits the two defenders. Goes left, but he's inside the 20. Stop is made by Corey Thompson, number 12. Well, they're coming alive offensively now.
One of the things that stuck out in last year's game was how injured Alabama was at the wide receiver position last year against LSU. Cooper went out of the game. They did not have a full slate of receivers in that football game. Ended up getting by in the skin of their teeth.
Kenny Bell has come on the field now in a late add. Jamarie Rasko hurries on for LSU. First down and 10, left side, Kenyon Drake. Takes that first tackle and gets out of bounds. 7:45.
Cyrus Kwanjo did a great job at left tackle right here. Watch him just take his man and give an opportunity for the running back to get outside. Completely blocked. Hunter, number 94, Danielle Hunter. And allowed Drake to bounce outside and use those quick feet. John Javis last year said, "I love Yeldon. I think he could be a star." They had Eddie Lacy. This year, they got Yeldon. He talked about Kenyon Drake, right?
Yes, that's right. And the red zone numbers for A.J. McCarron. 6 touchdowns, 0 interceptions. He'll feed Kenyon Drake again, and this time not anything going. Daniil Hunter, number 94, makes the stop.
It was second and short on the play, and they might have lost a half yard.
I think they did.
Yeah, now this, I mean, if last time LSU went all out with almost a goal line defense look. They were playing man-to-man on the outside. If they could force a field goal here, I think that would be a big win for this LSU defense.
Jalston Fowler, the huge fullback, has come in. Kenyon Drake remains the running back. Third and one. Drake got it. First and goal. Look at Kwanjo and Daniil Hunter. But it's a minor fracas.
Just pounding inside. Cyrus Kwanjo, Ari Kwanjo, number 77. Vern already mentioned Kelly, number 70. We met with Anthony Steen. He was the other guy nobody talked about a year ago. Yeah. Now he's the leader.
That's Steen, number 61, at right guard. Austin Shepherd, number 79.
Selling out inside, one-on-one coverage to the outside.
Fowler, the fullback. Yeldon is now on the field on first and goal. He comes to the right side and doesn't get much at all as DJ Welter, the middle linebacker, number 31, makes first contact.
John Chavis has been in this league a long time. He knows second and goal from the 8 or 9 yard line is a passing down. Let's see what he dials up here.
Chavis, the defensive coordinator at LSU, was for years the defensive coordinator, those chief, at his alma mater, Tennessee. A good man. 10th play of the drive.
Again, the tight end causes some problems being wide for LSU. It's something Alabama does not show a lot.
Blitz coming. McCarron deep in the end zone. Got it. Touchdown, Kevin Norwood. And he appears to be hurt. Kevin Norwood, the go-to guy for much of this year for A.J. McCarron. A.J. Chelt telling us yesterday how his dad, Tony, reflects the relationship between these two guys and Kenny Bell, number 7. He wears a t-shirt, and on the back it says Pops to 10, 83, and 7. There's Norwood.
You know, it doesn't look fancy. It's not a lot of movement, but Alabama subtly changed their formation and put this LSU defense under a lot of stress. McCary knew he had that throw before the snap.
Kate Foster for the extra point.
Kenny Norwood is going to pick on Jalen Mills again. He's the far inside receiver. These two guys are going to quickly come inside. Nobody back for an easy throw. McCarron knew it all the way. Inside technique, throw it to the pylon to the outside. Easy, easy play for an advanced quarterback. And A.J. has answered Mettenberger. He now is playing high level and throwing the ball all over the field.
Adam Zucker, New York, coming up on the Geico Halftime Report. Spencer, Brian, and I will get you caught up on all of today's action, including number 9 Auburn running all over the Vols, 444 yards as a team, nearly half by Nick Marshall, keeping the pressure on the Tide as we go back to Bama.
All right, thank you, Adam. Kevin Norwood appears to be just fine. Took a little shot in the ribs. Now it's time to take a look at our Home Depot tools for success. Gary?
Vern, whenever you do a home project, you got to have a plan. Well, the plan here was to take Ryan Vogler, the tight end, and move him out wide and read what LSU did. Now watch when LSU, what they're going to do is they're going to send their safety out there, Greg Lawson, number 6. When the safety runs out, right away McCarron knows that he's got this to the outside because he's got man-to-man to the outside. The plan was prepared and the plan was executed.
Now the result was a touchdown, Alabama. A.J. McCarron, see the scar on the side of his head? That is from a boating accident when he was a tyke 3 years old. It almost cost him his life. And look at him chatting with his teammates. Remember he told us he thought he was too calm in that game of the century here?
Said just before the game, quarterback coach Mike Groh came up to him and said, just be calm. Don't show any emotions. It's going to be a long game. And he said, it got in my head, and I couldn't get it out of my head the whole game. Afterwards, I said, I'm not playing that way. I'm going to be me. And even Nick Saban came up to him and said, be yourself. Let it rip.
Yeah, don't be calm anymore. Odell Beckham. Oh, yeah, that's wisdom. That is an effectively smart play for Beckham Jr. Mentioned that missed field goal, 109 yards, only the fourth that Bill Martin of LSU could find in all of college football history. Which Alabama quarterback had the highest finish in the Heisman vote? Highest ever. Pat Trammell, Terry Davis, and Jay Barker. They all finished fifth.
Well, A.J. McCarron better finish better than fifth.
No kidding.
Yes.
Namath? Stabler? Those must have been some years. First down and 10. Terrence McGee is the running back. They've used only two tonight. Play action, Mettenberger. Looks deep, nobody there, so he'll trundle out of bounds. He is never going to win a foot race. Let's go back to the studio for a Ford update.
Thank you, Vern. Bama fans, remember these guys. The Notre Dame Fighting Irish in the running for a BCS bowl berth. T.J. Jones on third and goal, taking the long way home. They have a 14-7 lead right now on Pitt. 6.5 left to go in the first half. Vern and Gary, back to you.
Adam, thank you very much. 17-7 here, an even 5 minutes to go. All LSU in the opening quarter. More or less all Alabama in the second. Second and 7. Terrence McGee stuffed. Adrian Hubbard there, but the key man, Jeffrey Pagan.
That Alabama defensive line, last year was Jesse Williams in the middle. This time you got different people doing the same things. Ivory just stuffs it, two gaps it, and then cleaned up by Pagan. It's a huge third down here. LSU's 3-for-4. Remember, they get the ball to start the second half. A first down here is huge. They do not want to put their defense back on the field.
Landry and Beckham top of the screen. Mettenberger deep left side. Caught. Kadren Boone, number 86. A big first down, as Gary said. Ha-ha. Clinton Dix made the tackle.
Well, it's the second time, arguably, LSU has gone after Alabama's best one-on-one cover guy, Deion Blue. And what a great adjustment Boone did on that pass.
Kadren Boone, only six catches before that one this year, two for touchdowns. Alfred Blue is in, number 4.
Look at that ball.
Brother.
Look at that football. It's an NFL arm. Those are NFL receivers. When they give Zach Mettenberger an opportunity to step into the throws, that's about a 40-yard throw across the field, and Beckham just abuses that defender.
And it was Deion Blue again.
But, you know, Beckham, he can get open in the NFL.
Yeah.
I mean, that is a very high-level pass route right there.
7 of 8 for Mettenberger. Here's Landry in motion. Play action. Mettenberger, defender slips. He goes deep. Almost picked off. Mosley with the try for the interception.
Yeah, this one on first down should have gone right out of bounds. Alabama defended the play. They tried to slip the back in the flag. Just get rid of it. This was almost a disaster. He had Robinson, 86, in his face. And actually, if Robinson hadn't made the ball die out, it would have been intercepted.
And LSU already with two lost fumbles in the game. Alfred Blue is still the running back. Connor Neighbors is the fullback to the right side. Play action again. And it's caught by Blue. He's hauled down by C.J. Mosley.
What a football player this man is, C.J. Mosley. Extremely intelligent, a great leader, schools everyone all over the field, does his keys, and does it every play. He had the back, he took the back, he ran down the back.
And another key third down. It's third down and 6. 2:31 to go. Landry and Boone now top of the screen.
Will Alabama come with pressure on this or only bring 4?
That's Hill out of the backfield. They stunt defensively. They bring 5. Mettenberger hit. Finds Jarvis Landry, who hurdles and is knocked down. A first and goal, LSU.
This is an odd look from Alabama. The man went in motion. Nobody followed him. They still blitzed, and nobody covers the inside receiver. Had to be a mental mistake. Nick told us yesterday that he could not believe, as Mettenberger again throws under pressure, that in the game last year, we must have made 100 mental mistakes. I think that was one right there.
And the 14-yard gain gives LSU a first and goal with Connor Neighbors and Jeremy Hill in the backfield. That's Neighbors leading the way. Play action. Mettenberger tumble in the end zone, and no flag, no call.
I think their feet got tangled up. Beckham wants the call, but the call was that the players got tangled up. No harm, no foul. Matched up against Blue again. Yeah, his feet just slipped out from under him on that play.
Second and goal.
Landry and Beckham, number 1 and number 2 receivers, split to the wide side.
And Landry, as he usually is, in the slot. Cyrus Jones plays off of him, number 5. Hill, nothing. Third and goal.
Little surprise Alabama isn't using their timeouts here. And there's still time. If they took a timeout here, they would still have the opportunity to have one last drive before the half.
Both teams with three timeouts remaining.
Remember last year, that last drive was with 1:18 to go in the game.
We're nearing 60 minutes, or 60 seconds, I beg your pardon. I was looking at Saban and thinking of 60 minutes. Third and goal. Mettenberger lobs it. Caught. Touchdown, Traven Durrell. That's his sixth catch of the year.
It's one of those bunch routes that the NFL coaches bring with them, and Cameron brought with them, and it confused the Alabama combo defense that time. Three players crisscrossing all at the intersection. One of them goes to the middle. Of course, LSU knows who's going there, but Alabama doesn't. A perfect touch pass. What a drive and answer for LSU.
Durrell, a redshirt freshman, his first touchdown catch of the year. And here is Colby Delahousie. Seth Frugé is the holder. And Reed Ferguson, the snapper. Extra point up and good.
Look what's happening over here for Alabama. There's only two ways to do it. It's either two receivers or three receivers. Here's four defenders on three bunched receivers. I believe it's this man comes inside and takes it to the touchdown play. Let's see how they crisscross and see if Alabama gets lost. Yeah, stutter and go. Matches up inside on Collins. Perfect read, perfect matchup, and look at that touch pass.
Well, that made the Mad Hatter happy. 17-14, Crimson Tide. Full house at Brian Denny. They're seeing a good one. And coming up at halftime, the Geico Halftime Report. We'll go back to our New York studios with Adam Zucker and the guys. They'll get you caught up. All the scores and highlights from around college football as we get deep into the season in 2013. 17-14 here. Top-ranked Alabama leading the 13th-ranked LSU Tigers. James Hairston will kick off. Christian Jones and DeAndre White are the deep men. Short. DeAndre White at the 3. 20. Oh, boy. Down at the 23-yard line with 36 seconds to go.
At 36 seconds, if you remember, had Nick Saban used one of his three timeouts, there could be at least 30 more seconds. They would be a minute 6 left in this half. It's a lot different when running a 2-minute drill or a 1-minute drill, however you want to put it, at your own 25-yard line with a minute rather than 36 seconds.
Well, your point well taken, Garrett, that last year in Baton Rouge, they took over the winning drive. With, 1:28 to go, I think?
Yeah, remember, Alabama loves to use the screen pass in this situation. Let's see if LSU remembers.
Yeldon is the running back.
Interesting.
Ego Ferguson makes the tackle. It's a rather placid play.
He's going to take it to the half. Well, if you think about LSU's first half, I mean, we talked about elite quarterback play. They got it from their quarterback, Zach, 10 for 13. Remember, they had 17 points that they could have had. Fumbled, they missed one, and two turnovers, they gave up 10 points. I think they've been the dominant team on the field, except they've been saved by Alabama's A.J. McCarron to even be in this game.
...17-14 Alabama. As we get set to go to halftime. Very impressive LSU performance. And again, we made this point when we came on the air tonight. LSU has won 5 out of the last 6 here.
Yeah, and remember that LSU gets the football to start the second half.
Down to Tracy with Les Miles.
Well, thanks a lot, guys. Coach, what can you say about how your team was able to overcome those 2 costly fumbles early to put up a score like this going into half?
Well, we're confident that we can move the football. We have to stop them. You know, we can get some tackles there, give them some long plays that they really didn't. We think we can defend. But if we don't turn the ball over, it's a different score.
How about the importance of that final drive there to even give your defense some rest going into half?
Well, it's tremendous. I mean, obviously that a 7-pointer in the back end, you know, takes the momentum into the locker room with us, and then we have the first possession. So.
Thanks a lot.
See ya.
You get the idea that no one is going to crack that security detail.
Yeah, he's well protected.
Except Tracy Wolfson. That's the end of the half, 17-14. Let's go to Adam Zucker in our New York studio.
All right, thank you, Vern. And coming up here on the GEICO Halftime Report, Spencer, Brian, and I will have all of today's action, including Missouri taking another step toward winning the East and Auburn keeping pace with Bama in the West after this word from your local station.
So before a full house at Brian Denny in downtown Tuscaloosa on the campus of the University of Alabama, we get set for the start of the third quarter. Moments ago, Tracy with Nick Saban.
Coach, J.J. McCarron doing a good job there in that first half, but what do you want to see from your team defensively here in the second?
Well, first of all, we got to control the line of scrimmage. And the second thing we got to do is get off the field on third down. We've had plenty of third down situations, but I think we've only stopped them once or twice, so we got to do a much better job on third down. So, and if we don't do that, we're going to have a hard time getting off the field.
Thanks a lot. Appreciate it. Vern?
All right, Tracy, thank you. And as you remember, I hope, LSU won the toss, deferred the option until the second half, and so trailing by 3, they will get the football. That means Odell Beckham Jr. is deep in the end zone. Dangerous kick returner. Cade Foster will kick off for the Crimson Tide. Third quarter underway. Beckham moves up, grabs it at the 2. Heads left. He's got some room if he can get by to the outside, not quite, but he is out near the 25. Well, Gary, we build this at the outset as kind of a battle of 2 of the really good quarterbacks in this league.
And it's turned out that way. If it wasn't for A.J. McCarron, Alabama would be in deep trouble in this football game. I'll help Nick out. It was 6-for-7 for LSU on third down. Alabama was 1-for-4, but in the second half, John Chavis has had Alabama's number in the last 3 matchups. 3 games in the second half plus overtime. Alabama on third down, 2-for-17 in the second half. It's got to be better than that for them to win this football game.
That will get your eye. First down and 10. Ball marked at the 26-yard line. Here's Mettenberger handing off. No play action. Goes deep left side. It's almost picked off.
Oh, my goodness.
And on the rebound, it's caught by Dylan Gordon. That's his 4th catch of the year.
Should have been intercepted. Ends up being a completion. First play of the half. You got it. You have to catch it, C.J. Mosley. You know he wanted to. It's one that he will dream about if Alabama loses this game.
On first down, this is Hill across the 50. And a flag is thrown. Well, he won't forget that, even if they win.
Yeah, it's going to be a face mask, I think, on this play from Ed Stinson, number 49.
Personal foul, face mask, 49 defense. 15-yard penalty at the end of the run, automatic first down.
Stinson just trying to make a play, reaching out. Get faked on the play, reaches out, grabs Hill, good call. different a play can be, huh?
Yes.
In the first half, it was Copeland fumbling a seven-point swing on one play. C.J. Mosley with a pickoff right there could have changed the second half flow of the game.
Neighbors, the fullback, leads the way left side. That's Terrence McGee. And let's go back and revisit those first half mistakes.
Well, in reality, these three mistakes by LSU was a turn of 17 points. Seven they didn't get on the first drive, three they give up there, and then on third down, that penalty allowed Alabama to score a touchdown a play later.
Second down, eight. McGee is the running back. He runs into Brandon Ivory and Ed Stinson, who collaborate for the stop. Let's take a look, Gary, at the first half trends.
Well, we talked about A.J.'s start, and I said that his play after that kept Alabama in this game. His throwing was brilliant, but the guy he's playing against is having another one of those nights. He had it against Georgia. He had it last year against Alabama. And then you see the turnovers and the 31 points. We don't got a 9-6 game going here.
No.
We got an NFL-style third down football game. Let's see what happens.
Third and seven here. Gary reminded you at the half, LSU 6 of 7 on third downs. The delayed blitz is coming. Mettenberger reads it. Landry stops short.
I think it was Jerick Williams that time.
It was. Number 20.
Well, Alabama has to know that on third down, LSU looks for Jarvis Landry. Bad snap on the play. Mettenberger makes a good catch. But that time, good pursuit by Jerick Williams to stay in this play.
And the field goal unit is on. That is Kobe Delahoussaye, who's only missed one this year. That was from 31 yards out against Furman. This is 41. Delahoussaye is 9 of 10 for the year, and this for the tie. We're notched at 17. Seventeen, 12:01 to go, third quarter. Oh, what might have been. C.J. Mosley misses. Dylan Gordon's got it. This is a game of some degree of physicality. We are back in Tuscaloosa. Time now for Red Lobster to present today's Scholar Athletes. We recognize the 13 players from the University of Alabama who have already graduated. 13. And you see at the bottom of the left-hand side, A.J. McCarron, Kevin Norwood. That's some accomplishment. Red Lobster's commitment to the investment of our future is shown today by donating $1,000 to Alabama's General Scholarship Fund. Christian Jones is deep. Hairston will kick off. DeAndre White is also back for the Crimson Tide.
Instead of a TV timeout, we were waiting for there.
Yeah. Please, don't blame us for that one. We were ready.
Yep.
Neither Gary nor I, in a rare occasion, had anything to say. This one will come out. Christian Jones heads right. Tries to get to the 20, which he does. And let's go back to the studio for a Liberty Mutual insurance update.
Yes, Vern, and another short break for you. West Virginia trying to show Texas what Morgantown is all about. Dreamiest Smith going in here to give the Mountaineers a 33-30 lead early in the fourth quarter. Back to you.
Wow. All right, Adam, thank you.
Yes, that's a big wow. A.J. McCarron now, remember, His start, let's go over it again, the second quarter, he was 6 for 6 for 117 and 2 touchdowns. But Nick talked about the line of scrimmage. How's he going to start this second half?
Yeldon is the running back. And Yeldon will get it, goes right guard, comes back to the left, nice opening. Well, on that last possession of the first half, A.J. McCarron with a touchdown toss. His winning percentage is now 94-3. Completion percentage, passing touchdowns. And with that last pass, he surpassed John Parker Wilson as the all-time yardage leader for Alabama. See, the rain continues to softly fall. It's not a problem, except for those who didn't bring ponchos or umbrellas. Yeldon. And let's see if you got it.
Well, you can see the emphasis at halftime. Nick said, we have to be balanced. I trust A.J. McCarron, but I believe in balance.
And they have been remarkably balanced offensively.
You know, Anthony Johnson, the outstanding defensive tackle, maybe hasn't had the greatest year for LSU this year, but he said that Alabama runs the ball differently this year. They're not the same power running team. I think he's right. They don't pull the guards as much, more zone blocking. They have not been smashing the ball against LSU like they had before.
First down 10, McCarron pulls it down, heads right. He will scamper out of bounds. Well, here's a quote from Anthony Johnson. Alabama, not a big power team. They run more zone. It's probably because they can't be more physical. At LSU, we want to be physical and punch people in the mouth. I don't know if that's necessarily locker room material, you think?
That's not like, well,
oh, okay.
If they got offended by red shirts when Tennessee mentioned that, I think they could get offended by anything.
Oh, you remember that. Last time we were here, Butch Jones refused to allow his team to say Alabama. He referred to it as the red team. Second down and 8. Yoga. Nice.
Yeah, you can just see the emphasis. We know, as we mentioned, we trust that A.J. is going to be able to throw the ball. But if we're going to control the team, control the game, and allow our defense to play defense the way I want, you could tell at halftime he said, I want to run the football. He challenges offensive line, and now they got a 3rd and short.
And they are 1 of 4 on 3rd down conversions. Gary mentioned how
2 for 17 in the second half in the last 3 games against LSU.
Left side. No, I don't think he got it.
2 for 18.
That was Lawson. Yes. Craig Lawson came up, and they're going to have to punt the ball.
Came up from the secondary. It's the second time in this game Alabama has been stopped on 3rd and very short. Boston came from the secondary and hit it on the run.
Cody Mandel will punt the ball. Odell Beckham Jr. is back to return it.
Remember when they had early in the game 4th and inches and they did it as well? Alabama only has 10 guys out there. Look, here comes number 11 now on the left side. The left wing just entered the game late. Alabama taking a timeout. They were ill-prepared.
So time taken by Alabama. Watch the play by Craig Lawson as he tackles T.J. Yeldon. 4th down. The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Cadillac. LG. Sonic. And by Bud Light. 4th down and 2. Alabama had to call a timeout. Absence of math majors.
You want to hear a matchup defense? Alabama only has 10. They bring out their 11th guy. Watch this now, okay? Whoops. LSU only had 10. They bring out their 11th guy. If they're going to go with 10, we go with 10. They go with 11, we come with 11.
It's the football equivalent of the 2-3 zone.
I'm surprised still that Alabama just didn't accept the 5-yard penalty. I wonder if they were thinking of faking it and did not want to give up the 5 yards. Fake.
They do fake it. They've got it. First down after the 47-yard line. Jerick Williams, number 20.
Because it would have been, it would have been logical to take the 5-yard penalty and save the timeout. Because they did it, they said we do not want it to go 4th and 6, and they ran and picked up the first down.
That was a direct snap to C.J. Mosley. He hands it off to Jerick Williams.
There's logic in this game sometimes. They just don't always follow what I'm thinking. That's the problem.
They're logic majors instead of calculus majors. And for more on that last play, let's go down to Tracy.
Well, guys, I was on the sideline watching the offense the whole entire time, and I don't think they had any idea that there was going to be a fake. McCarron was just talking to his offensive line. He was sitting down. He was looking down. And then all of a sudden, he heard the crowd roar. He looked up and realized he's got to get back on the field.
Great. Well, McCarron smiling in the mist. 2nd and 6. Yeldon, a little stutter step behind the line. And
nothing again.
And another big third down.
Yes.
Eagle Ferguson, number 9, made the stop. Daniil Hunter was also there, number 94.
Well, one of the things when LSU is going on third down, you can almost think it's Beckham or Landry. For Alabama, pick your poison. It could be anybody of 5 different players.
2 of whom are split to the left, 1 at the top of the screen. This is Cooper in the slot. Christian Jones. Cooper was the wide man. Here's McCarron down the middle. Got him. Amari Cooper. First down at the 35.
Well, it's not a really fancy route. You're just going to bring one receiver this way, one receiver into the middle on a dig route. Good protection inside. 4-man rush. Nice pocket. Nicely thrown ball. Another conversion. They did not get the third down conversion on the first one. They went for it on 4th. Nick sensed that his team needed something on this drive. He went for the fake punt. Good call by Nick Saban. And then the conversion finally on 3rd down.
First down and 10, play fake. McCarron has hit his last 7. He goes deep into double coverage, and that was incomplete.
Good job I lost in that time. Number 6, read his keys. One of the things when we were visiting with John Chavis about the play action pass, he said they're easy to read in film study. He says, I want to make sure my guys can do it during the game. The keys are obvious. If we follow the keys, we should not have a problem. Evidently, Boston followed the keys on that one. Perfect job by the safety.
John Chavis is the defensive coordinator at LSU. It's 2nd down and 10.
This 3-man package, 3 down linemen, 4 linebackers, has given Alabama problems.
Yeldon finds a crease to the 20. And a 1st down, Alabama at the 13-yard line.
Not on that play. Gashed him. Joe Brothers, 77 and 71. He just gashed right between them and took it almost to the house here. Good tackler. This thing could have gone almost all the way. I think it was Jalen Mills was maybe the last guy that could have saved the touchdown on the play.
Now Kenyon Drake spells Yeldon on a 1st down and 10. See the similarity in number of plays and yards gained. Here's Drake to the 5-yard line. Lamine Barrow, number 18, made the tackle.
Well, as we talked about already, John Chavis talked about Drake. He is quick. I mean, he's not 170 pounds either. He's a good size, you know, maybe 185, 190 pounds. He's not as big as the big running backs Alabama's features, but you can see how quick he is.
O.J. Howard, the tight end, who already has a touchdown catch, is on the field.
Yeah, Justin Fowler is also in there at wing back.
Hand off Drake going right. Driving is down at the four. Lameen Barrow, number 18, I beg your pardon.
That ball came out, but evidently late. Running to the right side this time. Good pressure inside that time by Anthony Johnson. Point of attack. Yeah, his knee was down. Came out late. No problem. Good call.
Brandon Green, number 89, third team tight end.
Third and a long, 1.5, maybe 2 yards.
What do you like here?
I think they could dial anything. I think they run off tackle.
Fowler and Yeldon are the running backs.
Good snap anticipation.
Yeldon gets a block in the corner. Touchdown, Crimson Tide.
What a drive. And what a good use of a timeout by the Alabama coaching staff. Again, Alabama could have dialed anything they wanted to. They dialed the bounce play, the stretch play to the wide side of the field, and Yeldon takes it in for the touchdown.
And he got a great assist from the tight end, Brian Vogler. That, folks, was a 14-play, 79-yard drive that chewed up 7 minutes and 50 seconds.
As Vern told you, Brian Vogler and O.J. Howard, nice job over here. No, I think it's Brandon Green, number 89. Vogler and Green, watch them two-time to the outside, a hook block, and then a release block on the arc. Beautiful job to get to the next level. You're not going to tackle that guy by diving on the ground. Too big, too strong. Alabama imposed their will and stuck it in the end zone with tough running.
Zucker, New York, with this Liberty Mutual Insurance update. Came down to fourth and goal between Houston and UCF. Cougars freshman quarterback John O'Korn off his receiver's hands, and George O'Leary's UCF squad holds on at home, taking over sole possession of first place in the American Athletic Conference. Vernon Gary, back to you.
All right, Adam, thank you. 24-17 here, 14-play drive. Let's take you back to a year ago and some of the Les Miles decisions in that game.
Well, he had 3 key decisions. A fake field goal on 4th and 12 that obviously did not work. And at the end of the half, attempted a 54-yard field goal with about a minute 18 to go that led to a touchdown by A.J. McCarron late. And then after a score, tried an onside kick. That's where Yeldon fumbled at the end of that drive. He was being very aggressive though last year. He kept his team in it and almost won that football game. Can't fault him. It just didn't work.
Rain's getting a little heavier here in Tuscaloosa. And the kickoff forthcoming. It'll be Cade Foster and Odell Beckham Jr. back to return. Well, we've talked a little bit about the All-American linebacker, C.J. Mosley. He's having a good night with one exception.
Yeah, he had one dropped interception, but he hasn't dropped many tackles, that's for sure. Reads his keys, hits it on the blitz, and remember, even when he's in coverage, he ran down the crossing route and made his play. Captain of that defense, and even more important now without Vinny Sanceri on the field to direct everybody and do those late changes that Kirby Smart employs with his defense.
4:11 to go, third quarter, first down 10, Tigers. This has become a fierce rivalry and living up to expectations again tonight. Play action, Mettenberger into the left flat, caught by Landry. Missed tackle. That's Denzel Duvall, and Landry picks up 3 more.
I don't mean anything against, take anything away from any of the coordinators that Les has had in the past. I mean, they've won national championship, all right? But the way this game plan is put together now really stresses you. Tailbacks out in the flat, wide receivers out in the flat, tight ends down the middle, post routes, comebacks. They attack the whole field against you.
Well, it's Cam Cameron, who's in his first year as the offensive coordinator. First and 10. Left side. Jeremy Hill out to the 40-yard line. We talked to Kirby Smart, the defensive coordinator for Nick Saban in Alabama yesterday. What's the biggest difference? There's Kirby. Biggest difference for LSU's offense. He said they have a very sophisticated passing offense now. Second and 5. Landry and Beckham bunched on the right side. Hill, Adrian Hubbard, got it, slowed him up. And then A'shaun Robinson was there, along with Trey DePriest.
You know, Vern, I don't want to say this offense is a lot better, but Les has a son that's a quarterback, Manny, plays for University High School. He likes the offense so much, he put LSU back on his list of teams he might go to now. That's how much he thinks this offense has improved. He had him scratched out before.
Third and 6. Noise level increases. Helped along by signals from the Alabama defense. Play action. Mettenberger. And that's Odell Beckham Jr.
We saw it with A.J. McCarron. We saw it with Johnny Manziel. We saw it with Aaron Murray. We're seeing it with Zach Mettenberger. The willingness to throw the ball to guys when they're partially covered. You just throw them open. That's the term they use. Just throw the ball. Depend on your receivers to get it. There's no hesitation from the quarterback. Very tough to defend.
First and 10. Play action again. Mettenberger drills it to McGee. How about the time it took for that to develop? And Deion Blue makes the tackle.
Good coverage that time. No pass rush, basically. Mettenberger surveyed the deep throw. Remember, first down throw. Be conservative. Be willing to drop it off. And he did it exactly as he was coached.
Second down 8. Kenny Hilliard makes his first appearance. And he's tackled right near the line of scrimmage. Again, that technique of attempting to rip the ball out. Brandon Ivory with the tackle.
Alabama utilizing that linebacker blitz. It's a run blitz on running downs. Taking an extra gap, forcing the bounce outside that time. Wonderful job of defense that time by Alabama, taking all the lanes.
Third down and 7, and LSU is 7 of 9 on third down conversions.
Let's see if Alabama doesn't dial up something and try to put pressure on Mettenberger. Looks like they will.
Mettenberger dropped again. Deion Blue. That is the second dropped interception tonight for Alabama.
Well, they overloaded the blitz from the left side, but it was picked up wonderfully by LSU. Plenty of time. Again, Zach anticipated his receiver getting open. He did not. And he's very fortunate he doesn't have another interception in this football game. 2 drops. I got to talk to Zach on how he does that. They always caught mine.
In the face of that, you lasted 13 years.
Yeah, well,
you know.
It's a bad one.
And it takes a backward hop. Jamie Keene, the putter.
Flag down on the play, though. Now, obviously, if it's against LSU, Alabama would decline that penalty.
Illegal formation on the kicking team, number 23. More than 4 in the backfield. A 5-yard penalty would be tacked on to the end of the kick. First down.
Tuscaloosa, 24-17 Alabama.
Adam Zucker in New York, they go back and forth in Nick Saban's home state. West Virginia's Paul Millard to Mario Alford, and he's got the speed. 72 yards for the sixth lead change of the game. West Virginia up 40-37 midway through the fourth. Vernon Gary, back to you.
All right, Adam, ours is not quite that high scoring, but we do have a 24-17 score here in Tuscaloosa. And we invite you to be with us next Saturday as our SEC on CBS crew moves either into Auburn or South Carolina. That choice will be made by Monday, and it'll all begin with the Auto Trader College Football Today show next Saturday at 3 o'clock Eastern.
Are we allowed to vote on which game we want to do?
We already have. We've weighed in heavily.
We got a feeling, a strong feeling.
A strong feeling. First down 10, McCarron, 10 of 15 so far in the game, two touchdowns. And his team in the lead. Here's McCarron. He'll scamper out of bounds.
Oh, they might throw a flag on that one. Absolutely.
That's Todd Jones, who's missed most of the last six games with a hamstring.
Silly. Well, he actually was trying to pull
dead
off,
ball.
But he waited too long.
58 defense, late hit out of bounds. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
You have to control your body. Even if you're trying not to do it, it's still a penalty. You could see AJ, he gave himself up. The defender is responsible for his body on the hit.
So that is the fifth LSU penalty. Worth another look.
Doesn't really matter if you tried to pull off. You slid into them, you tripped them, they're going to call it every time.
Well, we have reached the end of three. That's the end of the third quarter. The score, 24-17, Crimson Tide. We'll return to Tuscaloosa right after this word from your local station. Piece of music called Undefeated. And we go to the fourth quarter, a 7-point ball game. Vern Lundquist, Gary Danielson, Tracy Wolfson from Tuscaloosa. Alabama with an early lead, both teams with 14 in the second, and a 7-3 Alabama edge in the third. And we begin the fourth with AJ McCarron out of the spread, wide receivers right and left. Yeldon is the deep back. He'll get the handoff, go back to McCarron, the flea flicker. McCarron has Kenny Bell open and overthrowing.
Beautifully executed. Not the first time we have ever seen it doing Alabama football. When you can effectively run the ball, you have the opportunity to go for the home run. Well thrown, well executed, just about 2 yards too far.
And that brings up a second down and 10. McCarron will take it from the spread again. Comes to the right side. He's caught it. That's Kevin Norwood, his go-to guy this season. Gary, this is no shock. We go to the fourth quarter, and it's up for grabs again.
And in this series, know those of you who watch it closely know all the big defensive plays that have been made in this series to really alter the outcome. But, you know, everybody says Nick holds his everything close to the vest. He told Tracy what was going to happen. We're going to run the ball in the second half. Remember, the last five teams that have won this game, the last five games, the team that ran for the most yards have won the game.
And here is another one of those challenges. Third down and one. It's Yeldon. Squirts through the left side.
Oh, no.
That's very close. Greg lost it.
Yeah, I think he got it. I really do. I really think I thought from the spot he had it, but I might be second guessing myself. I think he got very close, and I think he got it.
Well, they will bring the chain out. Yeah, I think he did.
Uh-huh. Remember, that's just an approximation, but I thought from my eyes up here he had it too.
Yep.
And since I paid $400 for these glasses now, I'm hoping they're good.
Where did you find that kind of cheap optician?
I took the guy golfing. What can I say?
You must have. Wow, I want to see your doctor. And my new ones don't work.
Well,
first down.
Something better work for LSU real quick. I mean, they've been able to hold in these fourth quarters, but right now they're off balance with the run and pass game for Alabama.
Yeldon up the middle. Well, as we entered this week, last Sunday night, the BCS standings were released. Alabama on top, followed by Florida State and Oregon, then Ohio State. And then chaos on Thursday night, especially if you're a Duck. They were knocked off by Stanford. And we'll wait until tomorrow night to see who assumes that third position. You've got Ohio State. They were fourth. They're undefeated. Baylor with a huge win over Oklahoma on Thursday. Here's second down and six. McCarron is the leader. And he's under center this time. Yeldon. Oh, baby. Pound it, pound it, pound it.
Well, that wasn't soft, was it? It might not be the same style that Alabama had used the last couple years, but this time inside Kelly. Great job by Ryan Kelly. He helped on the tackle and then fit with the linebacker. What a job by center Ryan Kelly on that play.
First down 10 at the 27-yard line, 24-17. McCarron looking left, nobody open, settles for the short receiver. That's Yeldon inside the 15.
A.J. McCarron has been called a game manager. And I don't think you should take it all that personal as an insult. That's what a game manager quarterback does. On first down, if it's not there, drop it off to your athletes and get a first down the easy way.
Well, he had gaudy statistics a year ago when he threw for 30 and was intercepted only twice. This year, a little more modest numbers, but he's got two touchdown throws tonight, and he has not been intercepted. Handoff, right side, Yeldon. 10, out of bounds at the 5.
What a cut by Yeldon. TJ Yeldon just makes this play. Watch the cut. I believe it's this guy right here. Watch the cut. Outside, jumps inside.
Yep.
My goodness, what a play. Corey Thompson had no chance. That's as good as you can do it. An on-block defender in the hole, and he makes a miss. He wouldn't even have been able to grab his flag if it was flag football.
Yeldon has gone over 100 yards now, 19 for 104. He had only 29 at the half. Second and one. Fowler, the lead blocker. Play action, Fowler.
It's going to come back. Illegal formation by Alabama. Too many men in the backfield. This one's coming back. DeAndre White was not lined up on the line of scrimmage. You could see it the whole way.
Let's take another look. That's White, the receiver. Here's Matt
Illegal
Austin.
Formation on the offense. More than four in the backfield. 5-yard penalty. Pete, second down.
You could see five guys in the backfield. One, two, three, four, five. Can only have four. He should have been up.
So wipe out the touchdown. It's second down and six now from the 10. O.J. Howard, tight end, wide to the left, top of the screen. They give it off to Yeldon up the middle, bangs his way to the goal line, not inside.
First and goal, though, that was a first down. Look at that line. This time, Anthony Steen stiffs the guy right in front of him with a great block, stands him up beautifully.
Oh, there is some contact on that play.
Yeldon hit that one going full speed.
First and goal, Alabama, under 11 remaining.
And a big mistake was just covered up by that great run. They're going to check and see if it was a touchdown. They're going to go to the replay booth.
The ruling of the runner short of the goal line is under further review.
Man, look at that. Thought his left elbow came down before it got across the line.
It does appear that way.
Yep.
John Bible is our replay official here tonight. So it's in his hands right now.
It's going to be short. It's going to be right. I think they got it exactly right on the field. I bet they don't move it an inch.
There it is. Pretty clear cut.
One of the things, if I was A.J. McCarron right now, I would be telling my running backs, we don't need to reach out on first down here. Let's protect the football. Run through that touchdown line. Let's not get a cheap turnover here on first or second down.
The field is confirmed.
We don't need to reach it out and let them swat it away for a turnover.
First and goal for Nick Saban's Alabama Crimson Tide. 24-17, 10:46 to go. This is the 10th play of the drive. Yeldon. Touchdown, Alabama.
I tell you, Nick Saban was congratulating the right guys. He challenges offensive line. They have come through. And since he went for that fake punt at 17-17, 14 straight points.
And back-to-back drives now of 14 plays for a touchdown and 10 plays for a touchdown. Kate Foster with the extra point. McCarron will hold. The extra point is up, and it is good. How about the Yeldon run? He's had quite a night, including this touchdown from a yard out and the Crimson Tide up by two TDs.
And now it's time for our Geico game recap.
Alabama opened with a field goal to take a 3-0 lead, and this was Jeremy Hill, LSU's first touchdown. That gave the Tigers the lead early on. Beautifully conceived play here. O.J. Howard, the tight end, chased into the end zone. Alabama back on top. 17-7 after Kevin Norwood's 9-yard touchdown reception. And then Trayvon Doral. Touchdown catch, beautifully lofted pass by Mettenberger. This is what tied it up 17-17. But offensively, it's been a stalwart running game. This was T.J. Yeldon to break the tie, 24-all, following the fourth down fake punt. And moments ago, Yeldon in for the touchdown, the extra point good. Isn't this beautiful? The science and engineering building, Shelby Hall, on the campus of the University of Alabama, This is some scene on a game day here.
There's some games when Nick has to warn everybody not to leave. Today was not necessary.
No. And the rain seems to have subsided now. It was never terribly heavy. Kate Foster will kick off for the undefeated Crimson Tide of Alabama. Odell Beckham Jr. is deep. And he will bring this one out. Led by McGee, Beckham. Nice move, nicer move, even better move. Beckham gets a great block. A little hop and skip, and he's out of bounds with a brilliant kickoff return.
My goodness. We talked about 31 athletes were drafted from the 2011 game. Odell Beckham is going to be another drafted athlete in this football game. What a wonderful football player he is.
Well, that was an 82-yard kickoff return, his longest of the year.
We talked about Yeldon's cut. That was, I'll take yours and see you one.
Toss, Hill, going right, out of a tackle. Landon Collins strings him out, and then help arrives in the form of C.J. Mosley.
C.J. Mosley and everybody else with the red jersey wonderfully defense that time. Strung out. That's how you do it. You take it on inside. Hubbard did. Bounce it out. Collins is there. Ha-ha. Clinton Dix. And Mosley finishes it off.
Loss of three. Second down 13. Did I say the rain had stopped? Second and 13. Jerick Williams on the corner. He is not blitzing. Mettenberger goes deep to side, tipped and incomplete. Landon Collins, who returned 189 yards against Tennessee 2 weeks ago. It'll be third and 13.
Through to the outside, but he had Travis Dixon wide open. Alabama busted up the middle, and not sure why Zach didn't see it. That would have been a pass you would have read inside out.
Third down and 13.
Look, Vernon looked like he made up his mind. Remember, he had three interceptions throwing the ball to Beckham against Ole Miss. I think he made up his mind on that play.
Corner blitz. Mettenberger tipped again by C.J. Mosley. Fourth down.
Well, this time they came all out. C.J. Mosley was the free man in the middle of the field. He collected the blocker, and then he backed up in the throwing lane. Beautiful job. That's what the linebacker does. He collects the block, allows the safety to come inside of him, and then backs up in the throwing lane.
Trailing by 14 on fourth down, LSU will go for it. Jeremy Hill shaken up, not on the field on fourth down. Three wides to the left side. McGee now wide right. Four men down for Alabama. He called timeout.
Did he in time?
I don't know.
Prior to the snap, timeout, LSU.
Bear Hunt.
First timeout.
Well, we saw one miscue earlier with Porter and Mettenberger. This one, the timeout call in time. The Home Depot SEC on CBS is sponsored by Man of Steel, Verizon, Nissan, by Chick-fil-A. And let's revisit the requested timeout by Zach Mettenberger a moment ago.
Watch the call. It comes right at the end. Matt Austin is going to put his whistle in his mouth when Zach turns around at the last second. There's the call. He didn't signal timeout, but he whistled a timeout.
So it's 4th and 13.
Number one, you gotta have protection. That is number one.
Well, Pagan was coming hard. Mettenberger toward the end zone, incomplete. No flags. Ball will go over on downs. It was intended for Jarvis Landry.
Nobody open. There is no one open on this play. I think this is Landry in the slot right here, if I'm correct. Yes, he goes on a wheel route, handled very nicely by Geno Smith on the play. Forced him wide, and it was not interference.
Somewhat placid, Les Miles. Alabama with a 14-point lead. While we were away, Zach Mettenberger, the essence of frustration.
He had one opportunity, and I believe he had a misread.
Well, we'll take a look at that after this first down play. 31-17, 9-10.
It's not, it would not have been an easy play, Reed, but I think knowing Alabama, he should have assumed it was 3-on-2 and he had the inside of the field open.
Kenny Bell sets up in tight to the right side. Here's the handoff to Yeldon. And let's go back earlier, Gary.
Right. It was good coverage for the whole series, but on second down, Alabama is going to play 3-on-2 to the outside. That means inside, Travis Dixon had a linebacker 1-on-1. That's where the ball should have gone. Watch how open he would have been.
Oh, boy.
That is the M.O. of Alabama. They play the combos wide. You have the middle of the field opportunity. He did not take his read, I believe. Could be. That's why he's so upset.
And let's check in with Tracy Wolfson.
Well, guys, you saw the frustration. He just went over to Odell Beckham Jr. and he said, that was my bad. I should have made that pass. So much frustration from Zach Mettenberger down there now because he just knows he gave that one away, guys.
All right, Trace, thank you. Second down and 8. Well, we saw that look of frustration earlier this season,
but
the three-point loss
at
Georgia.
LSU only rushes the ball for 69 yards in the game so far. It's got to be all the quarterback. It's hard when it's just the quarterback.
Second down, 8. McCarron chased. Lets it go. Caught.
That's going to be
a late hit.
Absolutely.
Got to be. There it comes.
Frustration.
Yes.
Frustration there. That could almost border targeting. That could almost border targeting. Player is defenseless. Yep, that could be an ejection from the game.
Let's see if they call targeting here.
And I would be for it, to tell you the truth.
Yes, indeed. Certainly helmet to helmet. Lawson on Norwood.
No need to make this play. Yep. That's totally what they're trying to get out of this football game. I can argue with a lot of them, but not that one.
Lawson chatting with A.J. McCarron. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, Lawson said, I didn't mean it. I was trying to play football.
Following the play, dead ball, personal foul, number 6 defense, late hit, 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
They talked themselves out of it. I'm telling you, if they would have had a replay, they would have stuck to their original thought and called a targeting penalty.
Seems like a perfect example of this controversial interpretation.
Yep.
Targeting, most discussed new rule in college football in years. And that time, it was not called. First down and 10. Kenyon Drake in the backfield. Motion from Anthony Johnson. Drake drives across midfield. Tackle is made by DJ Welter.
Getting into the situation right now, Alabama's going, if we could get a field goal in this game, we could put it away.
Second down, 6. Nick Saban, by the way, he opened our conversation yesterday morning. Hi, guys, I'm going to be a grandfather.
That's right.
His son, Nick, daughter-in-law, Kelsey, baby due next month. Nick said the garage has a table that has been filled with Pampers for 3 months. Kenyon Drake.
You really got to give it to this offensive line now for Alabama. They are not the same offensive line from a year ago. They started out slowly in the Virginia Tech game, the Texas A&M game, even the Colorado State game. They had trouble running the football, but then they've kind of gelled. Seem to have found the communication necessary, a little bit different style. We talked about what they had with those three number one draft picks on the field, or two number one draft picks, and Barrett Jones, an All-American.
Under 7 to play, first down and 10.
Face mask.
Yep. Lameen Barrel, number 18.
You can sense the sense of urgency by LSU. They know they have to have stops. They
personal
know their only hope.
Face mask, 18 defense. 15-yard penalty, automatic first down.
They know their only hope is to keep Alabama out of field goal range, and they're just a little bit too jacked up at the end of this game here.
And Gary, remember what Nick Saban told Tracy as he came out of the locker room at the halftime? We need to run the ball, control the line of scrimmage. 121 yards rushing for the Crimson Tide in this half after 64 in the first half.
Well, LSU has not run the ball well enough. Mettenberger carried the team. A.J. McCarron carried the team for Alabama in the first half. But as Vern just told you, in the second half, Nick went in at halftime and told Tracy what he was going to do.
Yep.
He said it's a line of scrimmage football game, and I challenged our guys on the line of scrimmage to win the game. I was going to say damn game. Because
that's what he said. Okay. Well, you didn't have an end on the end. D-A-M. First down and 10. They'll run it again to the 10. Out of bounds. Austin Shepherd leading the way around the right side.
This is tough for the Pride. Look at this end of the line of scrimmage. A little block, a fit block between the tight end and the right tackle. Shepherd and O.J. Howard won a nice combo block from those two.
Yeldon now with 130 yards, 23 carries, two touchdowns.
And when Alabama runs for over 140 yards, they don't lose.
That's right. Yeldon and Fowler in the backfield. There's an ankle tackle made by Jermarie Resco. Getting a little chippy over in the near side. That's Austin again. On the right side of the screen, Austin Shepherd, and then Fowler.
Well, we saw it start on Thursday night when Stanford made a statement about physical power football, and Alabama is ending the statement in the second half of this football game.
It'll be Yeldon again on the handoff from McCarron. And a third down coming up. Tackle made by Ego Ferguson.
Well, the two-headed monster. First it was Mark Ingram and Trent Richardson, then Trent Richardson and Eddie Lacy, then Aisley and Yeldon. Now it's Yeldon and Kenyon Drake. They always use two, and they have different styles.
And they've got two really good ones who are freshmen who probably will not play in this game.
And they probably had three more on the sidelines that they're recruiting that are, what, sophomores and juniors in high school right now.
Absolutely. Third and goal. 4:20 to go.
Hold on to the ball. Can LSU force a tuner on it?
Play action. McCarron off his back foot. Fowler. Touchdown, Alabama. That's a 250-pound running back against a 210-pound defensive back.
I do want to show you what part of the game that I think needs to be addressed when the running back in the open field dips his helmet. Watch this. Look how he uses his helmet as a battering ram for the offense. That's something that people who are making the rules have to understand, that the defenders coming up have no choice sometimes. Watch him lower his helmet and deliver the blow.
That was Corey Thompson, who was on the receiving end of that helmet-to-helmet hit. Cade Foster for the extra point.
I would be in favor in the open field, if you lower your helmet, that they would call the dead ball right there.
. 38-17, 4:10 to go. Here's Fowler. First Thompson, Lawson.
Adam Zucker in New York. Some Texas fans think Mac Brown has stayed too long. He stayed long enough in Morgantown to get his first overtime win. First ever overtime game. Steve Edmund with the interception to clinch it. Six straight victories for the Longhorns. They are perfect in Big 12 play. Vernon Garrett.
Now congratulations to Mac Brown and the Texas Longhorns. A.J. McCarron winning his quarterback by percentage in Alabama history. He's about to go 34-2, and he's closing in on Jay Barker's record for wins of 35.
And I think it's a two-man Heisman race. I hate even talking about it till November, but I think it's between A.J. McCarron and Jameis Winston. And I don't think
really?
It should be decided yet.
Well,
this man could win three national championships. That counts for something.
And here comes the kickoff. Cody Mandel will kick off, the punter.
Interesting strategy. Low one right to him.
Beckham. He had one of 82 yards earlier. Don't forget, later in the game, the play of the game presented by Napa Auto Parts. 38-17.
After watching that kick, I don't think it was the strategy. I think it was the execution, because Nick was really upset. Why would you kick a line drive to the best kick returner that almost broke one last time? And he was very upset after that kickoff.
Well, we build this as a battle of two of the outstanding quarterbacks in the SEC. Mettenberger 221 tonight, but McCarron with another terrific night. Here's Mettenberger, first down and 10. Out of the backfield, Hill. Nice tackle. Jarek Williams, number 20, used his body, made the stop, but it is a gain of 20.
Great sportsmanship by Odell Beckham that time. He peeled back and blocked C.J. Mosley and then tapped him on the bottom and said, had to do it. I respect you, but I still had you lay out.
First and 10 after the 20-yard gain. trouble. Avoids the tackle. Ouch. Mosley again.
A little nimble.
Yeah.
But who cares? He's as nimble as Joe Flacco, and Joe Flacco won a Super Bowl. Who cares? If you can throw the ball and you know what you're doing, you can play quarterback in the NFL.
Second down, 11 with 3 minutes to go in this one. Alabama in quest of the SEC West, but more significantly, a third consecutive national championship. There's 8-on-8 again, Jeffrey Pagan.
Well, Alabama ranks 116th in the country in adjusted sacks rate. That means for the number of times thrown, they don't get very many sacks. But tonight, they've had a factor. They've been a factor with their pass rush.
I'm really proud of you tonight that you got adjusted sack rate into this ball game.
I didn't even know what it meant until about an hour ago.
Rain still falling here in Tuscaloosa. Alabama in control. 2:48 to go, 38-17. Alabama goes to Mississippi State next. And then they've got Chattanooga at home. See if Nick Saban urges the fans, the students, to stick around for that one. And then they've got this little trip to Auburn called the Iron Bowl. Third and 17 here.
And by the way, you mentioned that Alabama controls their own destiny, obviously, for the national championship and the SEC championship. So does Auburn. If Auburn wins out, they will win the West.
That's right. What a season Gus Malzahn has put together. Complete turnaround from the disastrous 2012 year. Third down and 17. Cadron Boone is the man who went in motion. Mettenberger sacked again. That's four. Cyrus Jones, the cornerback.
Delayed blitz coming from the short side of the field. Had to be a bust. I think Gerald Hawkins, number 65, had to pick up one of those guys. They only brought five. That should be picked up comfortably by your offensive line.
Well, this LSU team lost twice earlier this year, at Georgia by three, at Ole Miss by three, on fourth and 28 with 2:09 to go. They'll try something, 2:03. Fourth and Hail Mary. Timeout.
Yep. LSU.
He got it before the flag was thrown.
Yep, LSU timeout.
Time call, 38-17, Crimson Tide. Among those who have remained despite the rain, clapping her hands, A.J. McCarron's mom, Dee Dee Bonner, and just to the left, his girlfriend, Catherine Webb. And they watch now as A.J. McCarron may or may not make another appearance on the field.
That's it? That's all you're going to say?
You're darn right. I don't work for that four-letter network. Discretion. Fourth and 28.
Is that?
And he's hurt. He has taken a hammering tonight. Adrian Hubbard got him this time.
Good for you, Zach, to walk off that field. I love it. Do not lay down on that field. Go out like that.
And it appears his right knee.
just ran over the LSU line. One mistake, two absolute times they just ran him over. Too much at the end of the game. It was really a no contest. The game was over anyway, but that's not the way you want to finish, having your quarterback wither to the sideline.
McCarron will take a knee with 1:55 to go. Just to complete the story of McCarron and his mom, here's Mettenberger showing real courage. During the open week, AJ went home to Mobile, and his mother's birthday is November 27th, and he decided to throw an impromptu birthday party for her and the family, and as a gift, he gave her a necklace with his bowl championship ring, which, pretty nice gift. And of course, she didn't wear it tonight.
He's got some ring on there that said it had an A ring.
You know
on.
What? I thought he told us it was a necklace. It wasn't, apparently. Or second down.
Well, he has more than one.
Yep. He's going for three.
Well, what a football game for Alabama, but Zach Mettenberger had him 17-17. They had a stop on third down, and then the dam broke. The fake punt, and it was all Alabama after the fake punt.
41 seconds to go, the clock running. LSU is out of timeouts. Respect shown by both coaches. Mettenberger able to trot off. Good for him. With them both.
Well, let me start out. We just saw the embrace between the two of you. Take us through that and why that was so special.
You know, because this is such a big game for us. And Coach told us it was going to be a huge game. It's our toughest opponent so far. We had to play a 60-minute ball game, and Coach is like my second dad, so I love him to death.
I know he challenged you guys at halftime, said run the ball. How important was it to do that and show Coach you can live up to that?
Well, it's big. Anytime you can control the line of scrimmage, you control the game and you dictate how we play and kind of dictate what they do on defense. And that's what we needed to do. We needed to run some clock off, and we did that.
Well, the key play, the fake punt. After that timeout, take us through that, because it looked like you caught this guy off guard a little bit.
Yeah, well, you know, we were only going to run it if they were in punt safe. They weren't in punt safe in the beginning. We called timeout. They got in punt safe, so we ran the fake punt. And we worked on it for a long time, and the guys did a good job executing it. And I think then finishing a drive and going down and score was the difference in the game. But our players did a great job in the second half. I'm talking about we didn't play great in the first half, but we played great in the second half, and I'm proud of them.
You called A.J. McCarron the most non-hyped quarterback, the most non-hyped player, very underrated. Why?
Because all he does is win, and he does what his team needs for him to do to win, and people want to look at statistics all the time and just base everything on that. So, I mean, I think the guy's the best quarterback in the country.
Thanks a lot. Enjoy it, guys.
Well, what do you think, Gary?
Why would he not? He does exactly. It's easy to play when you throw the ball 40 times. It's hard to play for a tough coach. He's earned Nick Saban's respect. That's hard to do.
And our player of the game, running back T.J. Yeldon, 25 for 133. And he kind of exemplified the effort in the second half when Nick Saban told Tracy, we've got to run.
It was that front line of scrimmage, the defensive line of scrimmage, the offensive line of scrimmage, that's what turned the game.
Nick Saban runs like anything but a potential grandfather. Catherine Webb, D.D. Bonner, they're kind of pleased with the way things went tonight. And one more look. We'll be back right after this. Saying 17 LSU, 38 for Alabama, the final score. And the key play in the game, presented by Napa Auto Parts. It came with the score 17-all and a fake punt.
Fake.
They do fake it. They've got it. First down after the 47-yard line, Jerick Williams. They went on to break the tie 24-17. They wind up winning it big time.
I think considering how long it's been since they played a really competitive football game, that man was ready for it today. He produced. Nice reward.
Number one, Alabama will retain that ranking. LSU could not run the ball all that well tonight. Next Saturday, either Georgia at Auburn or Florida at South Carolina. Big victory for the Crimson Tide tonight as they go to 9-0. For our entire crew, Tracy Wolfson, Gary Danielson, I'm Vern Lundquist saying good night from Tuscaloosa.